Good morning. It's 7:52. You're watching Breakfast Television. Thanks for starting your day with us. Tessa Blakey from the Canadian Mental Health Association joining us this morning with tips for dealing with those negative feelings that can come after a big, highly anticipated event has come and gone. And we're saying weddings are a great example, planning a work event.
Yeah, even training for a marathon or having a big candidate party.
That's right. I've been planning a big party for yesterday, and today you're wondering, well, what do I do with all this time? It's normal to feel a little bit low after something like that.
Yeah, so there's two things kind of going on. One of those things is that in our brain, there's all these chemicals that help us when we're feeling really stressed or really busy that, you know, give us energy and like help us hold on to all those little details we have to keep track of. But as soon as we're not planning for that event, they're actually just going to contribute to anxiety. So in that week when we're trying to relax, they're going to stop us from being able to do that. So it keeps our focus on that event because we haven't actually given our brain the space to kind of get rid of some of that anxiety and that stress. We can do that through exercise, but that's one of the things that's going on. And then the second thing is we're emotionally invested. Like especially a wedding, right? But anything, we're really excited about maybe all of our friends coming over. We're really excited to see how something's gonna work out. And so we've developed a relationship to the event almost, and it's almost like a little breakup.
Yeah. Okay, so if there's an event coming up that you find yourself very busy gearing up for, there's actually some things you can do now to prevent that come down after?
Yeah, so making sure that we aren't going to lose our routine completely so that we're still holding on to some of those things that are a key part of our day so that when we're doing those things the week after, it's like, okay, well, this is like a rhythm. I'm in this rhythm. And that really helps us with our mental health because it kind of gives our day focus. And so our days after and before kind of feel the same, so there's less of like a drastic change. Okay. So that's number one. Another thing that we can do is just be really careful about how we talk about that event. So like, if this is going to be the biggest day of my life ever, right?
Right. Well,
if we're using that language, then after we're going to feel like the biggest day of my life is over now. Right? So we're going to...
So true. And a lot of people say that about the wedding. And that's, you know, it's normal to say that, but just being aware of that, because then you're kind of hyping yourself up.
Yeah, yeah. And so, you know, this is going to be a really exciting day. Right? As opposed to some of that other language. And you know, we call those that the way that we think about some of those things, sometimes they can turn into thinking distortions so that it seems like everything else after is kind of pointless. So it's just really important to kind of check in with how realistic we're talking about that event in terms of how our feelings are then going to be affected by that. And so it's interesting because we want to do that, and that's, you know, makes it like big and makes it exciting, but it's going to make that come down after harder.
Okay. So what to do if we're in the come down now?
Yeah, so I think that there's a couple things that we can do. We can plan something that we enjoy, something small that we can look forward to. Another thing that we can do is try to recognize what our thoughts are doing. So what are our thoughts about the event? Are we dwelling on like the little things that maybe went wrong? And how can we stop ourselves by doing that? And we've talked about techniques before to kind of change our thoughts. And again, you can find those online and on our website and stuff like that. If we have way too much time on our hands, then we can maybe start thinking about something else that we want to do, something that's going to occupy some mental space. Maybe we want to practice a new recipe. Maybe we want to learn a new language. Again, just something that's going to kind of take up some of that time. Another example we had was like after you move,
right?
You know, again, you're like, oh, I don't have to unpack boxes. What am I going to do tonight? Well, what did you do before that you can start doing again? How can you start to fill that time?
Right, because chances are you put something off to the side to make time for that event.
Yep.
To get that stuff back.
Yeah, like maybe you haven't connected with friends in a long time because you've been like, well, I'm way too busy, right? So what are some of those things that we can restart? Another thing too is that we really need to get rid of, kind of flush out some of those anxiety producing chemicals in our brain because, and they were so useful, like they're so important when we're planning the event, but they're still there after. And we do that through exercise and good sleep and nutrition. So we really focusing on those fundamentals of our health for our physical body and our mental health.
Well, summer can be a very busy time full of wonderful and exciting events, not the best events of your life, but very exciting ones.
Yes, exactly.
All of the resources available through the Canadian Mental Health Association. And again, if need be, there is professional help available. Put those
Seek
links
it out,
up there.
For sure.
Thanks so much, Tessa. More BT coming up. Stay with us.